Hello and welcome. I'm Prabhu Chawla. We are hosting a special show which we call Express Expression, without fear or without favor. Today's topic is global consequences of Chinese military misadventurism. All the newspapers are full of headlines. Everybody has a point of view. Who's saying what? We don't understand. Dissecting the narrative which is going on China-Indo relationship is very difficult. People are taking predetermined stands as if they are the experts, and those who are dying on the border know nothing. We have got a great panel here to discuss, and all of them have worked in the field as well, and they are the best person to give us a proper perspective of what is actually happening and what it means for the world and India. We are not confining ourselves that whether A has won or B has won. How many bodies came back? How many bodies went back? That is not the discussion. Discussion is that how China is behaving or misbehaving with the rest of the world. Our speaker, one of the best speakers, one we have got, top speaker, Air Chief Marshal Arup Raha, PVSM, AVSM, VM, ex-chief of Air Staff, and Chairman Chiefs of Staff Committee. After that, we have Lieutenant General Syed Atta Hasnain, PVSM, UYSM, AVSM, SM, VSM, and BAR, and ex-military secretary of Indian Army, and ex-corps commander, 15 Army Corps at GNK. He is the person who has been in the field also. And finally, we have Commander VK Jaitley, an Indian Navy veteran, coordinator IIT in Nations, ex-OG for Nation, and professional for India. As an IIT graduate, he has done massive work. He knows inside out of operations what happened in the Navy as well, and he's expert on military affairs as well. He will be moderating most of the questions. I'm just a civilian sitting outside looking at the situation from an ordinary citizen. Like many other anchors, I don't have a predetermined position. I will frame my questions, gentlemen, on the basis of what all of you say. That has been a philosophy. Let the people answer who know the subject. I would draw to get information out of you so that things become easier for those who are watching this show. So over to Mr. Jaitley or Commander Jaitley to ask his first question.
Thank you, Prabhu Chawlaji. So nice of you. And thanks for inviting me to this August forum. And I'm in the company of two great military stalwarts. So let me ask the first question to Lieutenant General Atta Hasnainji. Sir, since yesterday, I am listening to the news and it is quite disturbing that opposition parties, some of them, only one or two, in fact, yesterday when the Prime Minister was speaking, he got the total support from all the political parties except two. And I don't have to name those two political parties. Everybody knows it. Now, I'm surprised. And they are putting accusations also. When army does something great for this nation, and when some political party questions it, it really hurts me as a Fauji. And I'm sure you are also a Fauji, sir. Can you throw some light on what is the actual situation on earth? Actual situation in Ladakh, sir. Lieutenant General Atta Hasnain, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much, Prabhu Chawlaji, for inviting me for this discussion. It's my pleasure and honor to also be with my course-mate, Air Chief Marshal Arup Raha. I think most people are not aware that we are actually also course-mates. And therefore, I'm also very happy that the air power part of it is all going to be answered by him, because right through my 40 years of my career, the one thing which always overwhelmed me was air power. I could never really understand how the airmen, these pilots, would ever go about doing what they were doing. Amazing things, absolutely. Having said that, yes, you are right. We have been observing over the last few days and yesterday evening's events. To my mind, not a failure in any way. It was out of 20 parties, 18 parties were absolutely on board, and the other two parties also extended their support, but were putting a lot of questions at the same time. I was reminded about 1971, when at that time Mrs. Indira Gandhi got the fullest support. In fact, she was called Durga by Atal Bihari Vajpayee. In 1999, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, as the Prime Minister, got the total support of the political opposition. In 1994, when India was under intense pressure of the international community, on 22nd of February 1994, the entire all the political parties came together and passed the resolution, the joint resolution of the two houses of parliament. So we have had a history of tremendous political consensus. There's no doubt on issues connected with national security. Now, at the moment, it become a political commentary, so I don't really want to go into it. At the moment, we have a situation where there is a very deep ideological divide in India, a political ideological divide in India, the kind which has not existed for very long. And therefore, political parties are always looking for issues on which brownie points can be made, some kind of a pressure can be placed on the government, while at the same time trying to project that they are actually supporting the government in terms of national security. So I would say this is a very, very temporary kind of a thing. We should not take it too seriously, because there are far larger issues than just the political divide. And those are the issues that we should be actually addressing. The situation on the line of actual control is such that the Chinese have decided, to my mind, they have decided the reason why they have come at such a point in time in 2020 is there are three prime reasons. Number one, the strategic environment of the world is rapidly changing, and they are sensing an opportunity that they can be the prime movers with their narrative to set the world, new world order in 2020 and beyond. And sensing this opportunity, they are feeling their way around. You can see it's happened with Taiwan, with Hong Kong, with Vietnam, with Malaysia, with Australia, and they're doing it with India as a large neighbor, where they feel that this message will probably go out to the world best. Number two, the second very important aspect is the issue of the deficit in their own image that they probably perceived after 2017, the end of Doklam, where it was perceived in India and around the world projected that the Indian army had probably bested the PLA at the border and stopped it in its tracks. This was something not acceptable at all. And of course, connected to it is Xi Jinping's ambitions of fast-tracking the rise of China much faster than what has been laid out by the 19th Congress of the Chinese Communist Party, which is essentially looking at 2035 and 2049. So these are some of the prime reasons. And at the tactical level, the Chinese probably thought that with the ramping up of India's overall military capability, infrastructure, everything put together, opportunities were getting lost now. And if they allowed India's strategic confidence to build up in such a manner, then perhaps it may become too late to impinge their capability, their power on India to show it that it is second best. So these are the broad, this is the broad reasons why I perceive why the Chinese are doing what they're doing.
Sir, I was told that this Daulat Beg airport, the landing facility for the aircrafts, question to Air Chief Marshal Arup Rahaji, that airport has instigated China to a lot. They are really disturbed with the presence of that Daulat Beg airport, which has been commissioned sometime back.
You want me to say something on that?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. You know, one of the reasons, in my perception, why the PLA, instigated by its own political leadership, the Communist Party, has orchestrated this event, the standoff, etc., is the DBO itself. Daulat Beg Oldi is a very strategic advanced landing ground. We call it ALG because it is so strategically located in this region, which is so close to the LSE, just about 8 to 10 kilometers. And the strategic road that Border Roads Organization is constructing, which is 235 watt kilometers long, and it is reached close to DBO or this area, Galwan River, Shayok, along the Shayok River. They are now feeling threatened that DBO would play a very important role in operations of the Indian Army in this area. in terms of reinforcement, air supply, bringing in logistics, arms, ammunition, manpower, everything. So that is one of the reasons they want to make sure they occupy strategic heights from where they could keep DBU under observation and also disrupt operations from there, even during peacetime if required, when the buildup is taking place and things like that. So that is one of the reasons. But let me tell you what DBO's importance is and how difficult it is to operate from there, from the air warrior, airman's point of view. DBO is the highest landing ground in the world. You know, the Indian Armed Forces are renowned for operations from everything so difficult in terms of terrain and climatic conditions. Nowhere else in the world you'll find such natural, you know, I would say challenges. So DBO is an altitude, as at an altitude of 16,700 feet. And it is a dust track, well maintained to my mind by the army engineers, basically, because, you know, an aircraft landing there, you have to prepare the surface. That's what they do, and make it fit for operations. Being at almost 17,000 feet, where the atmosphere is so rarefied, very little oxygen, that you require actually oxygen when you go there, and all of a sudden you land up there in an aircraft, you have to use oxygen from the bottles. Yes. While others are acclimatized, they can stay there without that support of oxygen. So landing and takeoff from there is not permitted by any aircraft manufacturing company of the type of aircraft, because it exceeds the limitations of the envelope of the aircraft operations. The limits of the aircraft operations in terms of landing height and landing takeoff for AN-32, which you operate from there, and C-130, the Hercules special ops aircraft, which you bought from the Americans, is actually up to 12,000 feet. Very close to the height of Leh and Thois and things like that. But to operate from 17,000 feet, which is another 5,000 feet addition and height, it is actually barred. It is not allowed, because it will stress the aircraft to such limits that you might have damage to the aircraft structure, etc. The landing speed will be almost 1.5 times the normal landing speed. If at the sea level, your landing speed 200 kilometers for an AN-32, it will be close to 300 kilometers. So it will stress and strain the structure of the undercarriage. It will also stress and strain the, you know, the rubber surface of the undercarriage. And the engine performance, etc., will be reduced. And in fact, if you have some problem with the engine, you can't even switch off, because you cannot restart an engine at those altitudes. So there are a lot of challenges. The pilots will fly beyond the envelope of the aircraft that it has been designed for. So that is the challenge. And I think our engineers and our pilots are extremely good professionals. And they prove to the OEMs, original equipment manufacturer, that we can do better than what you have recommended. So that's the difficulty of operation. So
Chief, I'll ask you a question. Sorry, yes, because yes. This is interesting information for me. Are we saying that we are the only air force in the world which has operated plane at that highest altitude in the world?
You're absolutely right. There is no other airfield at those altitudes. No other airfield in the world. So that is the beauty. And in fact, in the 60s, the Packet is to fly. The Packet aircraft looks like a bumblebee. And everybody says, how can this aircraft fly? It beats all the aerodynamic theories of physics. So, but this aircraft had an extra engine. It's called the jetpack, the third engine. And with the help of the additional thrust, this, you know, Packet aircraft is to land regularly there. And
Commander Jetli, because you will not ask yourself question, I'll ask you question now. Because you are going to ask everybody else, but so who will ask you? So I'm looking from the Navy point of view. You are expert in this. You are reading, you are writing, you have been doing many things. From the naval point of view, what kind of role? Because China is a place where there is no Navy role involved. But how do you look at point of view of Navy? How to contain China? Is there any way where Navy could have also played some role somewhere?
Yes, sir. Andaman Nicobar Islands, they are located at a beautiful strategic position. And during last few years, the Andaman Nicobar command has been made a tri-services command. And in India, that is the only tri-services command, Army, Air Force, Navy. They are all under the same lieutenant general level officer. Now, from there, our army also can take part, our Air Force and Navy, all the three together, they can actually block the supply chain of merchant shipping of China from there. They can stop their routes. Somalia, you know, China got perturbed with the so-called pirates in Somalia. And they had to send their special ships to contain them. And all the countries also joined. If they were scared of the Somalia pirates, just imagine if Indian Navy goes in full force and tries to choke their all shipping lines, China will feel very, very disturbed. And China is dependent, their economy is dependent on a lot of exports and imports, lot of. And that all happens through the shipping routes.
So Navy is important in that for Andaman Nicobar. They can block everything there.
It's very well located.
If I may add, you know, there are two important straits, the Malacca Strait and the Sunda Strait. And there is one more. So these straits are the choke points in the movement of shipping through these areas. These are very important areas. So those can be actually used as strategic choke points to be blocked by Indian Navy, Indian Air Force aircraft based in the Andaman Nicobar Command. They're very close from there, and it will be very effective in terms of action against shipping and cutting down the supply lines, supply chain, as Commander Jaitley mentioned.
If I want to know Malacca Strait, you have spoken about, just you have spoken about Malacca Strait. I remember reading somewhere that the Indian companies were getting some contracts there and Chinese wanted to stop them. Is that correct? They were able to success, they were successful or not?
I do not know about this, but definitely, you know, China is always trying to build its capabilities in the Indian Ocean region, especially in this area, because of their vulnerabilities. So they are trying to influence the countries in this region to be friendly with them and have some control over these important straits, Malacca Strait.
Let us settle for one question, all of you.
May I add a line here? Can I just, because there is a strategic aspect to this. Let me tell you, it's the Chinese economy, which achieved 14% growth rate at one time and averaged 10%. What is this economy based on? On manufacturing on the eastern seaboard, completely. The eastern seaboard is supplied for energy by the sea lines of communication from the Persian Gulf through the Straits of Malacca, right through the South China Sea and up to the eastern seaboard. And the finished products, container traffic, also comes by the same route. So 80% of China's energy goes by this route, and 80% of China's container traffic goes by this route. Now, when you're looking at this, the possibility of choking it, but it's not so simple. You see, HE Marshal Raha will agree with me. When you send an infantry platoon across the line of control, you may not start a war. But if you send one Indian Air Force aircraft across the line of control, you will start a war probably. The same with the Navy. You say with the Navy, you try doing anything in terms of the freedom of navigation in international waters, not alone you, the international community will come after you. So you have to be very careful with what you say here. And of course, you can do this with China only at a pinch when you have the fullest capability. And that is the reason why the Americans want us in the Quad. They want us along with Australia, Japan, and everyone along with that.
General, you have put a point there, but I'm just looking at the possibilities of what can India do to block and choke economic activity of China. When the global atmosphere is against China, you raise the question about global implications. Global, if the entire atmosphere in the world is against China at the moment, India can block the movement of ships and whatnot that is going to happen there. But let us go back to the basic question, because Mr. Jetty is also there. I'll get back to him again because he has to explain certain things. Let us settle one question. Debate about what is LAC, because the opposition party now is charging that we are redefining LAC, redefining boundaries, because Prime Minister categorically said that China did not enter our territory. And how did the people die? Where did they die? How did they die? These questions remain. As the operation person, General Sinan, because nobody should question the Prime Minister's statement. The Prime Minister, with full responsibility, says they did not enter India. Did we enter China?
Okay. Let me try and answer this question. Firstly, I entirely agree with you. Once the Prime Minister of India has made a statement and with full commitment, with all his advisors advising him, there is no question that I, for one, will put any doubt on that aspect. The line of actual control is actually a perception. It's a perception. The Chinese have a certain perception and we have a certain perception. And in some areas, this perception matches. In some areas, there's an overlap of the ground. Because of that overlap of the ground, we like to go and establish our claim over our claim lines of the NAC, and they like to do similar. So what happens is the standoff between our patrols takes place from time to time over the last maybe 10, 12 years that this has been happening. We have been following benign drills as a part of our overall agreement. We've been following benign drills of putting flags to say you have reached the limit of your patrol. Don't come beyond this. This is our area. Similarly, they do the same. Then they leave behind some telltale signs like some tins of fish and milk and chocolate wrappers and things like that to say that this is our claim. So this is the kind of thing which has gone on all these years. Now, suddenly from 2017, this whole thing became a little more virulent, should I say. Because the Chinese started establishing their claims a little more robustly. And obviously, it was to the extent to the attempt to try and intimidate India. That was the whole aim, intimidate India. As far as your question regarding the Indians, no. To my mind, the Prime Minister's entire statement and perception is actually based on the incident of the Galwan Valley. He's not talking of anywhere else. He's talking essentially of the Galwan Valley.
Yeah, correct.
That was the point of focus in this inter-party meeting, this thing with multi-party meeting, which was there, which was going on. In that, if you see the line of actual control.
Chief also and colleague, Mr. Jitli is more well-informed when the government sources are concerned. I just want to know because people have died. People have disappeared.
Absolutely.
Those sides have happened. Let me complete. The question arises for a gentleman or ordinary people who want to know if people have died. 40 of them have died from 5-6 different states. Dead bodies have gone there, wrapped in a proudly tricolor of India. And they have died for the nation. People would like to definitely know that they did not enter our territory. Why can't you say, yes, we entered their territory, wanted to beat them back wherever they were, and in the process, we were martyred. But the question is, Chief Rahab, I will ask Arup, what could the perception, how do you interpret? You are the person on the ground also, you can feel. When you say people have died, when did they die? They died when they were going that side. They died when they were passing somewhere.
Can I explain this? You know, Prabhu Chawla sahab, I have commanded my unit almost in the same area.
J&K, yeah.
Not in Galwan, but in Pengong. So I was commanding officer of the unit in 1994-95 in this area. So I have this clear perception of what the line of actual control is and what are the type of operations which take place here. Now, on the 6th of June, when there was an agreement, military agreement between the core commanders of the two sides, some directions were given to both sides to carry out de-escalation and probably move back. The Chinese, as true to their nature, are not rule-bound. They are not a rule-based. They don't believe in rules. And they were dragging their feet.
Yes.
So obviously, our side was a little more impatient on it because we believe in implementation of rules. And that is the reason, to my mind, there has been no inquiry, nothing so far, but this is what I gather. That the commanding officer was probably given directions to go and negotiate and tell them to go back. Now, at the same time, there was some structure for observation of the traffic which had been put up on one of the hilltops, which was clearly in violation of the line of actual control. And the commanding officer with his men, this patrol had gone there, they had brought that structure down. And subsequently, they were waiting for them to bring down the second structure. That didn't happen. And then obviously a little impatience was setting in and they probably crossed the line of actual control primarily to go and speak. Now, there are so many times I have gone across the line of control in Kashmir to speak to my counterpart on the other side in a flag meeting. This was like a flag meeting. You were going on the other side to meet your counterpart on the other side. That is where the whole problem started. Now, the Chinese are very awkward people. First of all, the language is a major issue. There must have been an interpreter there. But despite that, something something sparked off. And there had been a history in the last 2 years of a little bit of this, what is called in Hindi, hatapai, with the given clubs and given sticks and iron rods. That is what started. Mukkebazi. It started off. That is what started off. And it was very violent. The commanding officer was hit and probably killed on the spot. And when the men at the rear, who were probably a little distance away, 400, 500 meters away, when they learned of this, then they, of course, they were there, their whole this thing was in they were in great temper. And you will find it's not single unit, not 16 Bihar alone. There are men from different units.
Air Chief Marshal, please, you tell us what is your information. Then I asked Mr. JT
okay.
to explain, Commander JT, to his sources, what are they telling you?
Right. Understood. You know, as General Atta Hasnain mentioned about the LSE, its perception, the border management protocols and, you know, patrolling protocols, policies, non-use of weapons, all these things are in place, mutually agreed. But as he also mentioned, that you can't trust the Chinese. They are always up to something and they have no rule-based operations. It is not, you know, Mahabharata, you know, you go by the rules that you set. So I think it is a trap. They actually stabbed our people behind the back. I do not have much information, but so much I've read in the social media, the strategic analysis, the interpretation of various satellite imagery, but nothing much has come from even our government, our spokesperson, but what exactly happened. And from the Chinese side, you can't expect anything to come. Whatever will come will be basically propaganda and information warfare. No truth, it will be all lies. And blame India. So since facts are not known to me, I would not like to comment. But I feel that we have been led into a trap and it has been orchestrated by the PLA. Because they came armed with such weapons, which is normally not used. So if they knew it, then our people would have been ready. Why should our army personnel be, you know, not ready to take them on under normal circumstances? But it was very special circumstances which was orchestrated. So therefore the injuries and the deaths. And I believe the ledge gave way. You know, it's a very treacherous terrain. The Galwan Valley, the ledge on which they are actually jostling and fighting or whatever it is. I believe because of the weight of so many people there, the ledge gave way and people fell into the flowing Galwan River, which is the hypothermia itself is a big cause for loss of life. And it was getting dark and people are fighting each other. There is no time to retrieve them maybe. So that is the reason to my mind. I really do not have the facts. So I'd not like to comment beyond this.
Sir, one question I want to
Commander
ask you,
Jitli, sir. Commander Jitli, I'm putting a question because you have your own sources of information being collected. Question is, because I'm still not clear whether they entered or did not enter, because something has happened which led to the scuffle or whatever, Mukkebazi you call it. In the process, we lost 40 jawans and martyred them. Question arises here, is the LSE so flexible that it can change hourly basis, yearly basis? Is there a defined LSE on the map or not? I don't think it is there. LSE, as there is a buffer zone also, LSE, if Prime Minister says nobody entered here, so we believe it, nobody entered here. So something has happened, it must have happened the other side. Chinese are trying to confuse that LSE is a flexible line which can be changed overnight. Commander Kohli, come on.
Okay.
Sir, this LSE thing can best be described by our Lieutenant General Atta Hasnain ji, that how many kilometers it is marked and how many kilometers it is fluid, as he was explaining. I think we will request him to explain this, General Sahab.
General Hasnain, I'd also request you to explain salami slicing tactics and strategy followed by the Chinese to nibble away on our territory on the LSE.
You see, there's a lot of confusion between the line of control and the line of actual control. The LOC, which is 750 kilometers long, starting from somewhere near Akhnoor and ending up almost near Siachen. This is a well-delineated line, demarcated, delineated, maps exchanged, signed, and the signatures of no less than General Prem Bhagat exist on the Suchetgarh agreement. And that is why there's no dispute on this. There are one or two places here and there where there's a little give and take with the Pakistanis, But by and large, it is like this. And of course, it's manned. The 750 kilometers is manned, except for the small gap, one or two gaps here and there. Here, on the line of actual control, the system is very different. Here, there's no demarcation. 1993, when we signed the Treaty of Peace and Tranquility with China, one of the first major issues in it was, let's get down to demarcating at Ellis, so that you don't cross this side, we don't cross that side, and we can negotiate in peace with each other. We don't have pinpricks and triggers taking place from time to time. The Chinese just did not want to do this. Now it is 27 years since then. We've had 22 meetings of the Border Protocols Committees. They have refused to discuss the Ellis. Maps were exchanged once in 1996, I believe, and subsequently they were taken out and there were no further discussions were held on this. So, we may give a map with a certain perception and they have a certain other perception. And as I told you, there are overlapping areas in the middle. And there are large tracts of territory like this. This also exists in Uttarakhand, in Himachal Pradesh. Sikkim, of course, is a broadly settled border. There's nothing very major there. They are trying to up the ante in Sikkim for different reasons now. And Arunachal is all based on McMahon Line. That, of course, is also disputed by them because they say this is illegal because it was signed by the Tibetan government, who was not really authorized and which was never a part of, which was never really an independent state as per the Chinese. So this is the broad idea about the line of actual control. It is a fuzzy line as far as the paper is concerned, but Chinese perception is clear, our perception is clear. The two perceptions do not meet. These perceptions do not change every day. The Chinese keep attempting to change it. Now, the aspect of salami slicing is certain year come, occupy a certain area, let the discussions continue over it, let the standoff continue over it, move back up to a certain point. You may have moved 500 meters inside, but move back only 400 meters. So 100 meters is occupied. This is the essential aspect of salami slicing. Right? Over a period of time,
Marshall wanted to say something. Yeah, please.
No, basically that salami slicing is the tactics or the strategy that the PLF follows, because they don't want to settle this till the time other big issues are settled, which are quite different. It is not about land. It is not about how they're deployed there, but it is about bigger issues, which to my mind, the perception they have about India, the way they want to put India down, the Dalai Lama's presence in India, the exile Tibetan government in India, located in all these issues are very important for them. So till the time those issues are settled, to my mind, they'll continue to keep it alive and they'll keep needling us in this fashion. That is my input on this.
I've read something in the social media also, and it's not verified, that there's some kind of internal dissensions against their leader there now, which is happening there, and maybe it may be a diversionary tactic to get India involved, because that's what happened in Pakistan also. When the Pakistan leadership in trouble, they started troubling in some kind of Kashmir. Do you think that because the local leader, their boss, is in trouble there because he's not been able to handle the economy well, even the pandemic he has failed to handle, he's coming back. If there is a connection between domestic politics and adventurism and misadvantage of the Indian borders?
You want me to answer that?
Air Chief Marshal, please.
Okay, right. I just wanted to tell you, in my perception, there are five basic causes, immediate causes now, which has actually been the reasons for them to orchestrate this event. Okay, first of all, they don't want India to build that strategic road.
Okay.
So whenever we construct anything useful, infrastructure, on our side of the LSE, well inside normally, they will raise a hue and cry. They want to sort of bully us in stopping that activity there. But it is not so when they do it on their part of the NTR, Tibet Autonomous Region across the LSE. There will so much of infrastructure, airfields have been built, okay, quite in depth, I would say, not too close to the LSE. They have built extensive network of roads. The lateral roads, the axial roads, they have access right up to the LSE. So it helps them in quick mobilization, supply chain, supply management, logistics, troop deployment, and they can you know, sort of get into a battle gear with ease, with reinforcement, etc. But we do not protest. But whenever we do it, there is a human cry because of this reason. One, so they didn't want us to build this strategic road, which is actually a very important road. Second is DBU, I mentioned to you, is very close to that area. It has got an importance in terms of logistic supplies, deployment and reinforcements, etc., etc. Third is, as you said, they're trying to divert the attention of their own public who are so dissatisfied with this present regime, especially so when the entire Chinese population, people all across the world, their diaspora, are being threatened because the dislike the world has developed toward the Chinese, the distrust, the mistrust they have developed because of the Wuhan virus pandemic. So they are in a corner. Now they are trying to play this game to the gallery, that means for their own internal consumption, to make sure that they prop up the image and the narrative about the leadership of the, you know, CPC, as well as their, you know, president, the lifetime president, and the invincibility of Xi Jinping. So that is the third reason. The fourth reason I'll tell you is that they do not want India to cozy up to the US. They're already fighting a battle with the US on various issues. Trade is one. And now after the Wuhan virus, when America has suffered the maximum, most probably the whole world has suffered, they want to hold China accountable for what they have done, for the opacity. They want to take them take the responsibility for what they have done to the world, destroyed the world's economy, and death and destruction to my mind and livelihood. And the last point is that they do not want other nations also to incline to join up with the US and the other forces who are inimical to China. So it is a signaling basically for other nations. It is kind of a threat and warning to India that do not lean towards the US. These are the five reasons I could, think of for this.
Commander Jaitley, please.
I want to ask one question. In case of all-out war with China, suppose, let's hope it doesn't happen, but suppose there is a war, all-out war with China, which are the countries you feel can actively play a role? Because some people are saying Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, Vietnam, etc., they all can come with India and choke China fully. Do you feel that possibility will be there? This question is to both of you, sir.
You want me to go ahead first?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. This issue is wargamed in different establishments and think tanks on a daily basis. Right. And the conclusions which we come away with, mostly opinion of very, very experienced diplomats. You see, I don't deal with diplomacy. The air chief marshal doesn't deal with diplomacy. We deal with war fighting, right? But very seasoned diplomats have all told us, and this afternoon there was a particular show in which I was participating where also it came out. The world will keep privately telling you, we support you. We support you against China. The only country will be one, the one and the only country will be the United States and a few countries of Western Europe. I do not believe there will be very many more countries because their economic interests are equally involved with China. Countries like, well, I don't want to name them, but there are many countries which profess very, very strategic relationships with India, very strong economic relationships with India. But I am convinced, and so are most of the diplomatic community in India, that when push comes to shove, ultimately you will find that publicly they will not support it.
Thinking is on similar lines that of the general here, Atta, my friend. So it's like this: when you have to fight, even the best of friends, we have the friendship and collusive power, two powers, our two neighbors. Did China come to the help of Pakistan in 1971? Even now they'll not come. Because nobody wants to get into combat where their own troops' lives are involved. As Atta mentioned, maybe the Americans. But I think, to my mind, as an independent, with strategic autonomy that we are looking for, we will have to fight this war ourselves. You do not expect anybody's support, anybody's help, anybody's putting their troops on ground with us or the Air Force or the Navy. it is better to be on our own. So therefore, we have to build our capability. The CNP, comprehensive national power, both soft power, economic power, human resources, space, IT, you know, cyber, AI, everything, as well as the military power. If we have a very good, you know, powerful military, then we'll be able to deter the adversary. And even now, I think we are quite well off to take on any aggression by China and give them a bloody nose. In fact, the whole world is looking at us, that we stand up to the bully, to the belligerent, you know, PLA and the Chinese leadership, and they'll learn a lesson, because if you stand up to a bully, they will always retreat. And if you give in, they'll sit on your head and you will suffer the consequences. And they
let me hear from you also, because you are saying that nobody will stand by us except US. They are 12,000 kilometers away from us. In that situation, how are we placed in terms of military might, defense might, vis-a-vis China? Because the perception is they are much bigger. They are also nuclear power. We are also nuclear power. But when the push comes to shove, at that point in time, is India capable of defeating, I would use the word defeating, final word, is able to control Chinese aggression, misadvisance, because they are always taking chances and creating trouble for us. Is India capable, when it comes like Pakistan war, like the Chinese war, because we still have not got out of those war defeat which we suffered early 1962. So that is still fresh in the people's mind. The China may create that kind of problem. Later on, of course, we got better of them in 1967. But what do you think, if stops now, are we capable of stopping them or pushing them back?
Right. This is a very, very significant question for this program of ours. It is not 1962, as you very correctly said. After 62, we experienced 67. And you saw what happened in 67. Jagan Sagat Singh, the man of his leadership, which established very clearly, given the will, given the leadership, and you will be able to deliver.
Yes, came to
1986.
Let him finish. Mr. Jaitley, let him finish.
Sir, very few people know about 1967.
After that. You speak.
1967. Then 1986, Sundaram Chu. 6 months to a year almost, Jan Sundarji's leadership at that time. We held on. We made sure we showed eyes to each other. There was no shots fired, but they went back. So it's not that we can't, we are incapable. We have a capability today. We have invested a fair amount. We may not have achieved the optimum levels yet. We have ramped up our infrastructure, particularly in Ladakh. Eastern areas, we still need to do a lot more. But push comes to shove. In initial border war, now that's what I want to classify. Wars can be of different kinds. If you only have a border war, limited border war, India will hold its own completely. I'm assured completely of that. But when you have a border war and you are on the verge of defeating a bully such as China, that border war is going to probably flow over into a general war. And that is going to cause a problem to you. Because you see, they are better in terms of missilery, they are better in terms of technology, cyber war capability and things like that. So comprehensively, a long drawn out war of this kind, India will probably hold its own. But at the end of it, a general war may not go entirely in your favor in the manner that you would like to see it. Air power is one thing which will hold its own. And that I leave to actually Marshal Rahat to explain.
Yeah, that's why I'm coming to. Commander Jaitley, you wanted to say something that about 67.
Yeah, I just wanted General to tell about 1967 what happened. We gave them a big blow.
Yeah, you see, 1967.
That everybody knows. But the question is, we gave them a big blow and they would never forget it. 1986 again, as you rightly pointed out.
The figures were 85 Indian soldiers killed and over 350 Chinese killed.
Yes.
Yeah, they don't remember. They won't forget that bloody nose at that time. They got it. I will ask the Chief Marshal again, because air cover is more important in such war. Are we equally equipped to handle, give the air cover to our army which will be fighting on the ground?
1962, air power wise, Indian Air Force was better than the PLAF in terms of the equipment, the vintage, the tactics, etc., and the capability, of course. But we did not use it because in those days, there is a fear that if you use air power, then the escalation matrix cannot be controlled. It is going to be full-fledged conflict. But it is not true as of now. You can always use air power. And you can always control the escalation matrix as well. you got to have clear-cut objectives, end states after every stage. At this stage, I want this and I'll stop. If the adversary does something else, we'll go up to this. So it has to be calibrated and it can be done. So now, as far as the Air Power is concerned and even the Army is concerned, in this theater, if you have border war or local conflict, like, you know, Atta mentioned, then you have only certain optimal forces who can take part. You cannot put whole of the PLAF, you know, whole of the PLA or the, you know, others. So it is certain amount of forces that can be deployed optimally for the best results. So you cannot put everything there. Therefore, even the optimal application of force, be it Air Force or the Army, we are slightly better off because we have better Air Force capability vis-a-vis the PLAF capability in this area, be the TAR. We have large number of airfields in the plains all across, right from the north western border to far east eastern border. And so we operate from the plains. We have the aircraft technologies who are four plus fighter aircraft. They will outdo the performance of the, you know, PLAF to a large extent. Secondly, you know, I think our people are battle hardened. You recently saw what they did in Balakot and then subsequent next day's air combat. So, and we have done a lot of exercises with the best of the air forces in the world, be it the USAF, the Russian Air Force, and the Royal Air Force, Australian Air Force, you know, South African, and everyone, French Air Force, and everybody has very high regards.
Let me put all three of you a specific question. Very short and short answer I want. Do you think, is there a possibility of a border war? I won't call a full-fledged war because attached use the word border war. Is there a possibility under current circumstances of a border war with China? Because Pakistan is dormant at the moment. They are just creating some problems there. If China is working as a proxy on behalf of the Pakistan to destabilize some kind of Indian system.
You want me to answer? Then I think attack can come.
All three should answer.
You see, border war possibility is there, but I would say it will be more or less localized. It will not be full scale all along the LSE that you have a conflict. One, because China cannot win in this border war. That I'm very sure, and I can assure you.
So are you saying that there's a possibility of limited border war?
Limited border war is what I'll go in for.
Yeah.
And you can use the air power. You must use air power. Then only you'll be able to tilt the balance in favor of the Indian force. That is one. Second, you know, is that the, in case it's a full-fledged conflict all along the border and then it goes into a full-fledged conflict, the loss to the both the countries will be immense. We'll go back by several decades, but China will not be able to come up as number one the power in the world for next 3 decades plus. So
let me bring in
a slightly different angle. I am getting more and more convinced that it is the Ladakh sector purely which is emerging as the center of interest for the PLA. And there's a reason for it. Because of the border of Gilgit-Baltistan, the Ladakh on one side, and which is free count as Ladakh completely, this is the area where collusivity between Pakistan and China can be most intense and most optimized. And the possibility, everyone looks at Eastern Ladakh, everyone looks at Kargil. The area where things are happening today is the central Karakoram Siachen sector. This is the most vulnerable sector. In the beginning, when Arup had spoken about DBO, the strategic importance of DBO is the capture of DBO means India loses the Karakoram and virtually loses the Siachen. Therefore, the Shyok Valley becomes a part of the Pakistan-China link-up. And that creates an arm, an artery of the new China-Pakistan economic corridor. You see the fragile corridor that exists today.
Is there a possibility?
I do not anticipate that it will go to that level. I feel that at the moment it is all posturing primarily to put India down and send a strategic message. If this thing ratchets up a little more through this campaigning season, next year will be a new year and we will see how it plays out.
Commander Jaitley.
My view is China will not dare going ahead full ahead war. They know
border war. I'm saying limited war.
Border war. Yes, sir. They will not go ahead for it because they know they will get a very big blow, which will be very, very bad for their economy, and their economy will just vanish. Today, just see how their badly economy is going to down just because of India boycotting. We are a very big market and we are giving them some, I think, $70 billion every year. So, which is a big money. So, the way sentiments against China is building up all over the world, they will not dare going full ahead war with India.
That's so, we're talking about global implications of this standoff which is happening between India and China, as Commander was mentioning, that China may be, in terms of hardware and software, may be much mightier than India at the moment in terms of numbers. But in terms of economic weapon, India holds the balance key. Or India, with the rest of the world sentiments, can they block China from this misadventurism? Because ultimately, China is a manufacturing hub of the world. Once throughout the world, there is some kind of a reaction to Chinese goods and other things. Do you think China can go back if that kind of economic pressure is built globally on them, get lost, or we'll throw you out of our country?
Would you like me to answer that?
Chief, let's go one by one.
Okay. I think the misadventurism militarily and its consequences are quite serious globally. Now, first of all, I must include all the skirmishes that have been taking place with China on one side, with all the littoral states of ECS, East China Sea, as well as South China Sea. And of course, India is another. So what will happen is if this bullying or hegemonic behavior and belligerent behavior continues, and especially post this COVID-19, the Wuhan virus pandemic, the whole world has lost interest in China. They have understood the vulnerability of doing business with China. As it is, many, many countries are trying to pull their businesses out of China, be it the US, be it Japan, be it European Union, Australia, including maybe others. And also people are going to prevent investment of Chinese monies in various countries. They're going to boycott the Chinese goods. So it is not going to happen over a day or two, maybe over 10 years, because we are so much into it. They have become they have outsourced everything. And Europeans, the powerful nation, the US, because I think it was the greed of the Western nations, the US, etc., to get cheap goods from China. They brought them on the world scene by giving them opportunities. They thought they'll influence them through market economy to become a liberal state, and their people would not suffer at the hand of repressive one-party regime. Communism had failed in USSR. Similarly, they thought this will also fail in this country, but it has not failed so far. But I can tell you, if they continue in this manner with their belligerence and fighting with everyone, then there will be internal dissensions as well, because market economy and the authoritarian regime do not go together. They do not gel. It is like water and oil. Okay, so you can give them, meet their needs, basic needs with market economy. But once you meet the basic needs, as per the Maslow's law, they'll also start looking for liberty, freedom, and other aspirational needs. That is repressive, authoritarian regime cannot provide. So there are a lot of dissensions, and they're already suppressing a lot of minorities, be it the Uyghur Muslims in Xinjiang, Tibet, Hong Kong, etc. There will be an eruption, I can tell you. Balkanization of China is very much on the cards if they continue in this fashion and deal with the world in this fashion.
No, I will ask General Atasman, because there's a question coming, because you are discussing economics here, boycott of Chinese goods and everything. And there's some kind of a new nationalism in this country, which talks about everything and looks into this kind of perspective. And China has been a permanent enemy of India in terms of whatever you want to call it, rightly or wrongly. There's a question here, is it truly possible for us to buy Chinese products without angering the PLA into doing something drastic? You know, at
all. Sorry, I there was a little audio break. Can I just?
Yeah, they are saying there's a question. Is it truly possible for us to boycott Chinese products without angering the PLA reaction into it doing something more drastic than what they are doing now?
Well, one of the assessments which was there very clearly about the PLA's so-called bullying tactics or Chinese bullying tactics was the fact that in the middle of the pandemic itself, India had gone ahead with the, I think on the HDFC or the HSBC bank, that we prevented the stakes, uninterrupted buildup of stakes of Chinese finances within the Indian banking sector, and we put controls over it. And that irked the political leadership in China tremendously. Obviously, India is a very important market for China. 350 billion middle class or more, a huge $1.3 billion population. So it's not easy to wish away India. But at the same time, I think India will have to be serious to do its studies clearly. Today itself, I was reading a couple of analyses which say it could be a double whammy for India. In the COVID, with the COVID situation and the downturn in the Indian economy, and now breaking supply chains coming out of Eastern China, etc., may not be the most appropriate time. And therefore, if we deny China suddenly the economic activity within India, it may actually bounce back on us. So I'm not an economist. I think we need to do a very comprehensive study on this. But the PLA, I don't think, is going to be irked by something like this. The PLA is very clear. It has got certain strategic objectives in mind. One of the major objectives which has not emerged in this discussion so far is to keep the Indian armed forces, the Indian strategic community, completely focused on the Himalayan belt. So that we continue building up our land forces, we continue building up our infrastructure, spending all the money there. Because the actual threat that China perceives is in the ocean, in the maritime zone. And that's the area where we are not developing and ramping up our capability. Which is why I am actually batting for the Indian Navy.
Yeah, Commander, you tell me what is your reaction on it? Because you have the votary of boycott Chinese everything.
I am a votary of boycotting Chinese goods by the public. As far as government of India is concerned, they have to follow certain rules, regulations, which they have signed in WTO. They cannot go beyond that. But still, within the rules, regulations, let them continue to behave. But the general public, they should boycott Chinese goods because they earn the money from us and then use that same money at the border to kill our soldiers. So general public should boycott all the Chinese goods as far as I'm concerned.
That's but right. It will not provoke China to act much more strongly and
no,
react.
Sir,
to
no, it will not, sir. No. On the other hand, they will be forced to kneel down and start building relations with the Indian public. Because they are benefited.
There's a question because India. Commander Jetley, there's another question which is addressed to you, in fact. They are saying, is the Prime Minister soft paddling on the China issue because he's close to the after the meeting last year and so on, 18 meetings have been held between the two. And after that, this is what he has given to Mr. Modi, who has unrolled the red carpet for him.
Sir, it is like that. If I come to your house and I have full intentions of building a relationship with you, building friendship with you, but you stab me in the back, is it my mistake or your mistake? It's obviously you have to be blamed. So Modi cannot be blamed for this by extending a hand of friendship with China. Modi tried his best to build relationship with all the countries surrounding areas, in fact, all over the world. And he has been very successful, even with the Muslim world. So many Muslim countries have given awards to Modi ji, which no earlier prime minister has got it. So same with China. He started to build very good relationship with them. But then it is they who have deceived us. It's just too bad.
Lieutenant General, I'll ask you one question which comes to my mind immediately. You see what Nepal is doing, and Nepal is controlled by the communists these days, and Pakistan, it is silent. Do you think now China has adopted its leadership role, like creating some kind of a trouble for India through Nepal, through Pakistan, and they directly themselves? It is some kind of a design behind it?
Well, probably the String of Pearls theory is old enough, it's 30 years old. And the building of relationship with Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Nepal, Pakistan and Seychelles and Maldives. All this has been a part of the strategy. There's been a give and take. We have done well with Sri Lanka. We have done well with Maldives. We are doing well with Bangladesh. Unfortunately, with Nepal, it hasn't really worked out, and somewhere things have gone wrong. We need to retrieve that relationship.
Do you see Chinese?
Whatever is the ideology?
Do you see Chinese role there?
Definitely, absolutely. When the chief of the army staff mentioned this aspect very bluntly, Nepal obviously reacted very, very negatively to it. But let me tell you, Pakistan on one hand, Nepal on the other side, all this is a part of the overall salami slicing strategy. The whole salami slicing strategy to keep India on tenterhooks throughout and not resolve anything with India.
Chief, I will ask you the question.
Can I elaborate on that a little?
I'll add that. You can explain whatever. But the specific question is the Chinese, this problem which is starting in Doklam, now it is happening in Ladakh, what they are doing. And is it they are trying to work, they are trying to wage a proxy war or some shadow war, or the indirect war or whatever on behalf of Pakistan also?
You see, the Pakistan has been their proxy state. Hmm. Their policy is very simple. Keep India engaged and focused on Pakistan. That means the whole world will equate India with Pakistan. It has been our fault as well. In the past, we've been doing so ourselves. I have been asked so many times by various people that we'll be able to take care of Pakistan. I said, don't talk about Pakistan.
So I'm putting different even questions.
So can you complete
your thing. I'll put another supplementary there. Is it right to say that Pakistan, by giving so much of concession to Chinese, entering through them, building roads, going to other parts of the world through Pakistan, are they demanding that, okay, we can't fight India, why don't you create trouble for ourselves? Is Pakistan using Chinese to create trouble with India?
It is they are working in collusion. And what you say is absolutely true, you know, that this is how they are playing a game against India. But they are making a huge mistake, I would say, Pakistan. They lose their, you know, they will be in a debt trap very soon. They lose control over the assets, which will be built by the Chinese, which has happened in many other states. So if they want to do good for themselves and not be determined to give 1,000 cuts to India and destroy themselves in the process, then I think they should be very careful about dealing with China.
This
has happened in Africa. African nations, Chinese have got there, given them a lot of funds, built infrastructure. They are trying to get their natural resources, minerals, timber, etc., basically through very, you know, shady deals, corrupt practices. Unfortunately, the leadership in some of the countries are not so clean. This is a BBC report I have read, and a very thorough one. And now they've realized that they are getting into debt trap and they are going to lose control. And once they want to come out of this grip, the Chinese become extremely vindictive against them.
Let me ask three of you very specific short question, because we're concluding now. I want to ask you, what should India do at this situation?
Prabhuji, if I can start, but I will take a little, you can edit it out if you like, but you can tell me.
No, I won't edit anything.
What I want to bring, something which has not emerged in our discussion, the basic Chinese strategy, the basic doctrine. You see, 1993, China came out with a doctrine called War Under Informationized Conditions. It was the lessons of the Gulf War I, where CNN entered into the drawing room of the world. Mm. From there, they realized the power of information. And 10 years later, in 2003, they came out with a new doctrine called the Three Strategies. The three strategies were essentially media warfare, legal warfare, and cyber and psychological warfare. Now, this is the essential strategy that China likes to adopt against any country around the world. They will psychologically swamp your mind to tell you you are just not capable of fighting them. They will retain a strong posture, have a lot of their armed forces, demonstrate a tremendous amount of what they're doing in Ladakh at the moment, depth areas of Ladakh, all that will happen. I think India just needs to hold on, have the steely strength, build up your armed forces there, show them that we are not going to be carved out, continue building up your infrastructure, look for greater avenues and greater resources for your armed forces, all these things needs to be built up and ensure you have a political consensus and continue building up a diplomatic support for yourself around the world. China will not go the whole way against you.
Yeah, Chief, what do you think? What should India do?
I want to add a few points.
What should India do? Because one thing which you are referring to, that what should India should be much more communicative. Do you think India should have a much more transparent communication strategy when it comes to China, which is who's expert in misleading the media and everybody else?
Absolutely right. You know, we have to stand up. We have to call out the misdeeds of Chinese, which have been very shy to mention. You know, they have done so much against us. Arming Pakistan with nuclear weapons. Building road the CPSC through the POK. So everywhere they have snubbed us. And we are trying to be friends with them actually. I think we need to stand up. But you know, there is a psychology working. The perception that the Chinese have about India. That is very important. I must tell you this. Just 30 seconds. The Chinese perception, the mindset and narrative about India is very, very poor. One, they have disdain for Indian democracy, Indian economy, Indian culture and values, Indian civilization, India's economic power. Disdain. Just mark my word. They don't feel that India is a competitor. They don't even think that India could be an equal and, you know, sit along with them at the high table like the UNSC. Okay, with a bit of power. So that's why they're against it. They have a superiority complex, which is based on, you know, their present achievements, not only the past and civilization achievement, all around economic growth, infrastructure, scientific growth, military, space, IT, AI, cyber, even sports. They have done so well. The Olympics, they're trying to project themselves as a kind of a superpower. So there is a huge ego, which the CPC is making use of for nationalistic fervor. And of course, they have become intolerant. And other countries, they feel, should adjust to their rise.
Their rise, correct.
Okay, and they want that in Asia, they will lead the economic resurgence and integration. It will be led by China, not India and, you know, Japan, South Korea and others. And anybody who cooperates with their adversaries, US, Japan, Vietnam, Australia, they are their enemies. Just clear cut. Okay, they'll threaten them, which is there, you know, clearly in the statement by the ministers and political leaders, as well as their, you know, mouthpieces. And of course, the presence of Dalai Lama is creating a lot of problems for them. They think it is an act or it's a hostile act. So therefore, we got to be careful about the perception that the Chinese have about us, and hence we must prepare ourselves with proper CNP to deter them and take care of the threat that is developing across.
Commander Jaitley, we have to forget now. I'll ask you the question, then you can add whatever you want to add. Commander Jaitley, for you it is specific because Nehru coined a word, Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai. ये अभी इतने साल से चल रहा है, कितने साल हो गए, 70 साल हो गए इस बात को. हिंदी चीनी भाई, नो मोर भाई भाई भाई, ये सब नारा लगाना पड़ेगा कि नहीं है हम भाई भाई, वी आर नो मोर भाई भाई.
नहीं, मेरे ख्याल से नहीं. इंडिया शुड कंटिन्यू टू एडवोकेट इट्स ओरिजिनल फिलॉसफी एज पर अवर फिलॉसफी ऑफ दिस कंट्री, वसुधैव कुटुंबकम, दैट वी बिलीव द होल वर्ल्ड इज वन फैमिली. वी वुड लाइक टू एम्ब्रेस एवरीबॉडी, बट एट द सेम टाइम अगर कोई हमको आंख दिखाएगा तो उसकी आंख निकाल देंगे. कोई हमारे साथ पंगा लेगा तो उसको छोड़ेंगे नहीं. दैट शुड ऑल्सो बी वेरी क्लियर. यस, वी वॉन्ट द होल वर्ल्ड टू लिव इन हार्मनी, दैट इज अवर बेसिक एम. बट यस, वी शुड बी प्रिपेयर्ड एनफ, वी शुड बी स्ट्रांग एनफ दैट नोबडी कैन लुक एट विद अस विद यू नो डर्टी आईज. दैट वी शुड बी वेरी वेरी क्लियर. एंड आई एम ऑफ दैट ओपिनियन, वी शुड नॉट से यस हिंदी चीनी भाई भाई, वी शुड कंटिन्यू, बट एट दिस टाइम हिंदी चीनी बाय बाय बी वाई bye bye. To their product,
Atta, that you give the final word. I'll give you another small question after that, when we'll conclude after this.
I strongly, as I already spoke earlier, I strongly believe that a bully needs to be bullied back. And the moment you show your weakness at any stage, at any place you wilt, he will climb on you and continue expanding his expansion into your areas. So I don't think we are a weak nation. We are a strong nation. We've got a good willpower. We have a strong political leadership. We've got a good political and democratic culture. Economically, we may have a downturn at the moment, but it's just waiting for us to bounce back. I'm sure that will happen. I think we need to hold on, but one aspect we need to really ensure we get hold of. We need more support for our armed forces as far as the budget is concerned. I think you cannot afford to think that you can defend your country by the 1.5% budget that you allocate to your armed forces. That is unrealistic.
That is defense budget, of course, is very limited and not coming up. Last question I'll ask you. As you rightly pointed out, India has got a strong political leadership, which is the most popular leadership according to all polls so far. Don't you think Mr. Modi trusts too much, Chinese trusts too much, and they have betrayed him, stabbed in the back?
See, Prabhuji, what happens is, if you remember...
Say one small, you're speaking like a diplomat, not like...
No, I'm going to give you a clear-cut answer on this. I'm going to give you a clear-cut answer. 2014, when this government came into power, as far as Pakistan was concerned, they did nothing with Pakistan. The first attempt was with China. Build bridges. Economics is the future. That's what stability is the most important.
He trusted
thing.
Everybody. That's the question I'm asking. He did that.
And his style of leadership was that. He did the same with Pakistan. He made a visit, a dash to Lahore from Kabul, if you remember, in 2015.
Yeah, the bad day.
He was stabbed in the back by Pakistan. India was stabbed in the back by Pakistan in 2016 with the Uri attack.
Modi should not trust these leaders.
I think you need to, as a nation, we need to keep learning our lessons. And we need to be more pragmatic on this issue. The Chinese particularly are not a rule-based nation. They do not believe in a rule-based order. And we should
They cannot be trusted, basically.
Yes.
Chief.
Yes. You know, while I advocate that we should stand up to a bully, build our overall capability in terms of military power as well as economic power, but final solution to my mind would be to have good neighbors, relationship with neighbors.
No, I asked you the question whether Modi mistrusted.
What about Mr. Modi?
Misplaced.
Right. Sorry. Okay. Now, I think, you know, every new leader will try his style to influence our diplomatic relations. We know what are the burning problems of the nation in terms of, you know, the border problems, Pakistan, China, and others. So I think he tried his best. But he got betrayed, so it's okay. We have given him a chance, and he now has learned his lessons, and he will.
So he should not trust China anymore, basically.
No, you should not. But I must tell you that there was a lot of plea from our side, as you know, General Hasnain mentioned, that defense budget. You cannot say that diplomatically you will be able to take care of all your threats. You will be able to, you know, neutralize all your threats or whatever it is. It is not possible. So if you have not invested in those 126 fighter aircraft, the Rafales, if you have not given enough money for the third score for Mountain, okay, I think we have made a solid mistake and we need to correct that.
You know enough. Rafale is yet to come. We are depending on Sukhoi as well as now, again, back to mix anyway.
And it takes time to build military capability. There. It doesn't happen over a year or two.
We can go on and on. China and India has been long relationship.
Yeah.
They are going through hills and valley. I think all of you made a good point. Common point seems to be that we should spend more money on the defense. We can't do anything diplomatically all the time. Diplomacy sometimes fails, sometimes it wins, but we have to spend more money on defense.
You cannot mitigate the threats through diplomacy alone.
Right. And second is, China cannot be trusted. Prime Minister Modi should look at other ways of telling China, okay, enough is enough. Time has come for us to stand back or face us. That is what the conclusion comes from this discussion. Thank you all of you very much for participating. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chawla. Thank you.